My dear brothers and sisters, today is a very auspicious day when we celebrate the 25th Jubilee of the Episcopal Ordination of His Grace Archbishop Vincent and Concessao. Archbishop Vincent of Concessao was born on the 28th of September 1936 at Puttur in South Canara of Karnataka state as the fifth child of Francis and Apollina Concessao. Vincent Michael Concessao has four brothers and three sisters now settled in different parts of India. His eldest sister is Kerasa, religious in the congregation of Bethany Sisters Michael, along with his grandmother, were partly responsible for his vocation. Vincent's father expired shortly after he joined the seminary. His mother too is no more. She left for her reward about 8 years ago. The young Vincent was educated at St. Francis Xavier Primary School, thereafter at St. Philomena's Boys High School, Puttur, Karnataka, from where he completed his secondary education. Perhaps inspired by the example of an uncle who was a priest, he joined St. Joseph's Seminary at Jep in Mangalore in 1961 and was ordained on 4th December 1961 in Mangalore. The young father Vincent was known towards the needs of the North, which he knew had to be addressed. An episode early in his life is recalling as it reveals an important aspect of his personality. A week before the end, Vincent was to leave his house and to commit himself to the service of the church. One of his loved ones had a serious stroke and paralyzed. He was advised by many to defer his plans, but he would not. He had set his hands to the plow and would not turn back. This total dedication to his vocation has characterized Archbishop Vincent ever since. Recalling this event, the Archbishop observed, "Had I not taken the plunge, then perhaps I would never have entered the orders." Of course, it was painful and very difficult decision, but by God's grace, I was able to find my peace and settle down in due course. Father Vincent came to Delhi in the year 1962 and was appointed as assistant parish priest at the Sacred Heart Cathedral, New Delhi. After 3 years of pastoral ministry, he went for his postgraduate studies in sociology at the Loyola University, Chicago, US, having completed his master's at Loyola and his summer course on development at International Cody Institution in Canada. He returned to Delhi and was appointed Director of Social Action in 1970. On the many fruitful areas of his involvement, Archbishop Vincent remembers with particular gratification the work he did in the resettlement colonies of Delhi. True to his character, he took up residence during this time, that is 1977 to 85, in an ordinary rented Delhi Development Authority Janda tenement at Madangir, identifying himself wholly with the people he served while he was still serving as Director of Social Action of the Archdiocese of Delhi, now christened Chetanalaya. He was given additional charge as Rector of Pradiksha, the residence of Delhi Major Seminarian, studying at the Vidya Jyoti College of Theology. He led a team of priests to set up a new mission in Rohtak, a district in the state of Haryana. He also served as the president of the Catholic Priests Conference in India. In the year 1991, he was called to the Sacred Heart Cathedral, New Delhi, where he had first launched his pastoral ministry and was appointed as its parish priest. 2 years later, he was elected to be the Vicar General of the Archdiocese of Delhi. In 1995, he was elevated to the episcopate and was made the auxiliary bishop of Delhi and titular bishop of Muscula. Father Vincent Concessao has been associated with many church-related organizations based in Delhi, such as Caritas India, Indo-German Social Service Society. He was one of the earliest members of the Catholic Priest Conference of India and was later elected as its president, a post that he held until his appointment as bishop. His episcopal ordination took place on the 1st of April 1995, New Delhi. He chose to bear witness to the Lord. As his motto and his coat of arms indicates, his involvement with the people, being in the world and serving it by radiating gospel values. Working among the poor, the Archbishop remains with a deep emotion and favor, has been a great experience. I have often been humbled by the generosity that I came across among them and have been struck by their awesome power to endure privation and suffering without grumbling. It has left a permanent impression on me. He is not a person to whom poor come to meet, but a one who himself goes to them. In 1998, he was appointed Archbishop of Agra, where he stayed till the turn of the century, when he was transferred back to Delhi and installed as its fifth archbishop in November 2000. Archbishop Vincent has been very much involved in the struggle for the rights of Dalits as a part of commitment to human rights. He is also an active member of various interreligious and multi-religious organizations which are committed to social harmony and peace through dialogue and collaboration in projects for the common good of all. Until 2013, when he retired as the Archbishop of Delhi, as we celebrate the Silver Jubilee of the ordination anniversary of His Grace Vincent, let us remember and pray for him, all his near and dear ones, and the mission that God has entrusted to him all through his life.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Peace be with you.
And with your spirit.
My brothers and sisters, my memory is getting weaker. Pardon me if I read the introduction. My sister, our God is a God of surprises. In today's first reading, We see how Nebuchadnezzar, the Babylonian king, had a surprise. He thought his furnace, several times heated up, could burn and destroy the three Jewish young people who refused to worship the golden calf and the king's gods. But he found the youngsters walking around in the fire without any harm. And he praised the youngsters, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, for their fidelity to God and courage, and their God for protecting them. Coronavirus was another surprise, and so is this Thanksgiving Mass. Our plans were different. Everything in the last few months got changed. And all of you know very well how things are changing very fast. Our God is a God of surprises. We do not understand his ways, but we surrender because we believe that he loves us. And all his plans are for our good and not for our destruction. Only a person of faith can take in his stride the surprises of God in serenity and thank him. At Mass, in the preface, you hear the celebrant saying, "It is right and just that always and everywhere we thank God Almighty." Always and everywhere. In good times and bad, in health and sickness. Modern technology has made it possible for us to come together in prayer and be bonded together emotionally in spite of the distance between us. Many more people could participate in this Thanksgiving service, though they are far from here. Let us thank God with a profound sense of gratitude for all his graces and blessings, and especially for the last 25 years of my episcopacy. And now, to prepare ourselves for the celebration, let us humbly acknowledge our sinfulness before God. I confess to Almighty God,
and to you, my brothers and sisters, that I have greatly sinned in my thoughts and in my words, in what I have done and in what I have agreed to, through my most grievous fault. Therefore, I ask Blessed Mary of the Virgin, all the angels and saints, and you, my brothers and sisters, to pray for me to the Lord our God.
May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Amen. Lord, have mercy on us, Amen. Lord, have mercy on us, Amen. Lord, have mercy on us, Amen. Lord, have mercy on us all. Christ, have mercy on your son. Christ, have mercy on your son. Christ, have mercy on your son. Christ, have mercy on us all. Lord, have mercy on your servant. Lord, have mercy on your servant. Lord, have mercy on your servant. Lord, have mercy on your soul. Glory to God in the highest, and peace to his people on earth. Glory to God in the highest, and peace to his people on earth. Lord God, heavenly King, Almighty God and Father, we worship you, we give you thanks, we praise you for your glory. Teach us, God, Holy Son of the Father, take away the sins of the world. Lord, have mercy on us. You alone are the Holy One. You alone are the Lord. With the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God. Amen.
Let us pray. Enlighten, O God of compassion, the hearts of your children sanctified by penance, and in your kindness, grant those you stir to a sense of devotion a gracious hearing when they cry out to you. To our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen. First reading, a reading from the book of Daniel. Nebuchadnezzar said to them, "It is true, O Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, that you do not serve my God or worship the golden image which I have set up. Now, if you are ready when you hear the sound of the horn, pipe, lyre, trigon, harp, bagpipe, and every kind of music, to fall down and worship the image which I have made well and gold. But if you do not worship, you shall immediately be cast into a burning fiery furnace. And who is the God that will deliver you out of my hands?" Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego answered the king, "O Nebuchadnezzar, we have no need to answer you in this matter. If it be so, our God whom we serve is able to deliver us from the burning fiery furnace, and he will deliver us out of your hand, O king. But if not, be it known to you, O king, that we will not serve your God or worship the golden image which you have set up." Then Nebuchadnezzar was full of fury, and the expression of his face was changed against them. He ordered the furnace heated 7 times more than it was wont to be heated, And he ordered certain mighty men of his army to bind them and to cast them into the burning furnace. The king Nebuchadnezzar was astonished and rose up in haste. He said to his counselors, "Did we not cast three men bound into the fire?" They answered the king, "True, O king." He answered, "But I see four men loose walking in the midst of the fire, and they are not hurt. And the appearance of the fourth is like a son of God's." Nebuchadnezzar said, "Blessed be the God of yours, who has sent his angel and delivered his servants who trusted in him, and set at naught the king's command, and yield up their bodies rather than serve the worship any god except their own God." The word of the Lord.
And thanks be to God.
Your response. O Lord, you are to be praised and highly exalted forever.
O Lord, you are to be praised and highly exalted forever.
Blessed art thou, O Lord God of our fathers, and to be praised and highly exalted forever. And blessed is thy glorious holy name, and to be highly praised and highly exalted forever. Your response.
O Lord, you are to be praised and highly exalted forever.
Blessed art thou in the temple of thy holy glory, and to be exalted and highly glorified forever. Your response.
O Lord, you are to be praised and highly exalted forever.
Blessed art thou who sittest upon cherubim and lookest upon the deeps, and to be praised and highly exalted forever. Your response.
O Lord, you are to be praised and highly exalted forever.
Blessed art thou upon the throne of thy kingdom, and to be exalted and highly exalted forever. Blessed art thou in the firmament of heaven, and to be sung and glorified forever. Your response.
O Lord, you are to be praised and highly exalted forever.
Gospel acclamation. The Lord says, "I am the resurrection and the life, and whoever lives and believes in me shall never die."
Glory and praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to St. John.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Chapter 8, verses from 31 to 42. Jesus said to the Jews who had believed in him, "If you continue in my word, you are truly my disciples, and you will know the truth, and the truth will make you free." They answered him, "We are descendants of Abraham and have never been in bondage to anyone. How is it that you say you will be made free?" Jesus answered them, "Truly, truly, I say to you,
Everyone who commits sin is a slave to sin. The slave does not continue in the house forever. The son continues forever. So if the son makes you free, you will be free indeed. I know that you are descendants of Abraham. Yet you seek to kill me because my words find no place in you. I speak of what I have seen with my father, and you do what you have heard from your father. They answered him, Abraham is our father. Jesus said to them, if you were Abraham's children, you do what Abraham did. But now you seek to kill me. A man who had told you the truth which I heard from God. This is not what Abraham did. You do what your father did. They said to him, we were not born of fornication. We have one father, even God. Jesus said to them, if God were your father, you would love me, for I proceeded and came forth from God. I came not of my own accord, but he sent me. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to the Lord Jesus Christ.
Dear brothers and sisters in Christ Jesus our Lord, when I was in the parish, I was called for a lunch, a family. Then I went for the lunch, so they prepared nice food, delicious food. Then I noticed a flower pot in the house, a very beautiful flower pot. And I was so attracted by it. I liked it. Then I asked the family, where did you get this? They did not answer. Then I asked them, can I get a branch of this plant? Then before I left, they told me, Father, this is a duplicate. It's not original. Then I doubted because it looked exactly the original. Then I went and touched the plant, the leaf. It was original. Then they told me, you go and touch the flower. Then I touched the flower was duplicate, plastic. And I asked them, how did you make it this way? Then she told me that the flower was taken and they put the needle and attached to it, and they painted it such a way that it looked like a original. Then I said, okay. Then I was coming back to my church, parish. What is the benefit of being a duplicate flower? You need not pour water. You need not put manure. It will never fade away. It will remain forever. But what is the problem in it? It can never give anything. It can never receive anything. Dear friends in Christ Jesus our Lord, let's ask ourselves, is our faith original? Is our faith duplicate? Today's first reading, three young men, Shadrach, Meshach, Abednego, three young men, they were tested their faith, even to die. They said, we would like to die than to commit sin or to worship the images. And they were ever ready to die for God. Their faith was tested and they came forth as original. Let's ask ourselves, when our faith is tested, is our faith strong? On the other hand, if you look at the gospel, Jesus was with them. Jesus was telling them, and Jesus was preaching his own word, Father's words, and they refused to believe. And on the other hand, they were always finding fault in Jesus. And they were never to accept Jesus as God. They said they were God's children only in their lips, but in their actions were not real to their faith. It's the option before us. Is our faith genuine and original? Sometimes we ourselves also ask, that we tell we are Christians, but when crisis, the problems come, where is our faith? Do we still trust God, or do we still hold on to the Lord? Three young men, the first reading said, let's ask ourselves, is my faith original or duplicate? Amen.
Brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Father Almighty.
May the Lord accept sacrifice at your hands for the praise and glory of his name, for our good and good of all his holy church.
Receive back, O Lord, these sacrificial offerings which you have given to be offered to the honor of your name, and grant that they may become remedies for our healing. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere, to give you thanks, Father most holy, through your beloved Son, Jesus Christ, your Word, to whom you made all things, whom you sent as our Saviour and Redeemer, incarnate by the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin, fulfilling your will and gaining for you a holy people, he stretched out his hands as he endured his passion, so as to break the bonds of death and manifest the resurrection. And so with the angels and all the saints, we declare your glory as with one voice we acclaim.
Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of hosts, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest.
You are indeed holy, O Lord, the fount of all holiness. Make holy, therefore, this gift, we pray, by sending down your Spirit upon them like the dewfall, so that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread and, giving thanks, broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it. For this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith. Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you have held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly we pray that, partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit.
Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world, and bring her to the fullness of charity, together with Francis, our Pope, Anil and Vincent, our bishops, and all the clergy. Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, Blessed Joseph, her most dear spouse, the Blessed Apostles, St. Francis of Assisi, St. Francis Xavier, St. Father Equim, St. Alphonsa, and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be coerced to eternal life, and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ.
Through him and with him and in him, O God Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. Amen.
At the Savior's command, and formed by divine teaching, we dare to say,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ.
For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever.
Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you. Look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen. Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
Let us offer each other the sign of peace.
Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, grant us peace.
Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb.
Lord, have no glory that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed. And may the prayer of my heart always be.
Make me a servant. Make me a servant. Make me a servant today. May you heal the sick and the crippled blind. Take back the sheep that's strayed. May I seek the Lord and the way be strong. With justice be the one. Give me a servant. Humble and meek. Oh, let me lift up those who are weak. And may the prayer of my heart always be. Make me a servant. Make me a servant. Make me a servant today.
Let us pray. May the mysteries we have received, O Lord, bring us heavenly medicine, that they may purge all evil from our heart and strengthen us with eternal protection through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Attend, Almighty God, to the prayers of your people, and as you endow them with confident hope in your compassion, let them feel as ever the effects of your mercy, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Almighty God bless you, the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Go in peace, glorifying the Lord by your life.
Thanks be to God.
Namorare.
Remember, O most gracious Virgin Mary, that never was you known, that you are looked for your protection, implored your help, or sought your intercession, was left unaided. Inspired with this confidence, I apply it to you, O Virgin of Virgins, my Mother. To you I come, before you I stand, sinful and sorrowful. O Mother of God incarnate, despise not my petitions, but in your mercy, hear and answer me. Amen.
Mary, your Mother, Queen of Peace and Channel of all Graces,
pray for us.
Just like to share a couple of things. Yesterday, as I was thinking, one thing is about the former bishops. You know, you have a new generation. The elderly among you probably knows some of them at least, but most of the diocese does not know the former bishops. Now, I had the privilege to work with all the three of them. The first one, when I came to Delhi, I was asked to be assistant at the cathedral. I was the sixth assistant. And Bishop Angelo was the coadjutor, was the parish priest, and there were five priests to help him, and I was the sixth one. Of course, now many of them have become parishes, these different territories they used to look after. And my room was next to Archbishop Joe Fernandez's. Wonderful man, simple, humble, great. And I really enjoyed being there. He used to come prepared with jokes at table and make everybody happy. That was Archbishop Joseph Fernandez. Then came Archbishop Adil Fernandez, was coadjutor and took over. Quite different type. Very much involved in planning, was a great speaker also, quite different, but great. And third one was Archbishop Allen, another type. But all of them were great men who inspired us. I certainly learned a lot from them, not by their telling us, but by living the values that they held dear. That's one thing I wanted to share so that the people of the present generation also know some of these old bishops who have built up this diocese at various stages. The second thing is interesting. I'm going to share it. I don't know what it is, but there must be something in it. You know, when we joined the seminary in the year 1953, we were 17. And during the 9 years of training, some of them dropped out, five, six of them within the first couple of years. Some of them were shifted to other seminaries, and some others joined our batch. Again, all of us together, these three groups, were 17. In 1961, or December the 4th, our batch was ordained, we were priests. Exactly 17. It's something really interesting to me that 70 number seems to have something with us. Secondly, I would like to thank Father Denny, who thought of this celebration. I had forgotten about it, but he kept raising the issue every now and then. If the diocese does not celebrate, we will celebrate, and so on. But the diocese celebrated three Jubilees together. Interesting, but it was nice. And this locally, again, we had different plans, but the God of surprises gave a surprise, and we had it today. But something which is nice is that many more people who otherwise would not have been able to participate in this, participated this time. Of course, it is a different thing not to be present physically. Nevertheless, to be bonded together emotionally and in prayer, no matter how far you are, is something wonderful. And maybe for the future, when your personal presence is not needed, like at Mass and other sacraments, there are ways of conducting meetings and all that without wasting time, without spending time on travel and all that. Maybe we will have better ways of doing it. So, Father Denny, thank you very much. And his right hand is Father Blessing. Blessing, I always like to hear that Blessing without G. Yes, but also been very helpful. And we are here, and now there is one more, Father Maria Benedict, Maria Anthony, again, very helpful. Good community, sharing and living together in peace and joy. God bless them all. And the singers, the musicians, and those who joined, thank you very much. It's all done in a small place, but it goes out all over. Yes, thank you very much. And I'd like to thank all of you who have been associated with this Thanksgiving service, for your presence, for sharing this sense of gratitude to God with me, and all those who have in any way been helpful. Also, I must not forget regular people who look after us. My driver, Alphonse, cook, Veronica, and a general helper, Samuel. God bless them and God bless you. Keep praying for me that I may have good health and keep going as I am getting older. Thank you and God bless you.
There shall be showers of blessing. This is the promise of God. There shall be seasons refreshing, sent from the Savior above. Showers of blessing, showers of blessing, mercy drops on us outpouring, but for the showers we plead, there shall be showers of blessing. Upon us, O Lord, that to us now are refreshing. Come and now honor your word. Showers of blessings, showers of blessings renew. Mercy drops on us appalling, but for the showers we plead, but for the showers we plead.